Well, the good news is that although esketamine is new, its sister drug, ketamine, has already a track record, and we don't really expect dramatic differences in terms of the outcome, both good and bad, between the two. So it's not catching it by complete surprise in terms of what's going to happen down the line. Now, with every treatment, there are caveats and downsides. And for ketamine and esketamine, here are the major ones. So there are some downsides, side effects that happen at the time of that treatment administration. And those side effects involve either the person feeling somewhat weird. We call them psychotomimetic effects. Essentially, these are described as dissociation effects that happen for about an hour after getting the treatment. People describe it's as if I'm looking at myself from a distance, as I'm out of body experiences. Others feel like they're experiencing a high. The good news is it's not lasting more than minutes to an hour after the treatment administration ends, but it may not be pleasant. The other thing that can be medically more serious is that people can have a significant increase in blood pressure and heart rate for a brief period of time after getting either ketamine or esketamine. And this is one of the reasons why actually the treatment is not recommended to be administered at home, even if it's not intravenous but intranasal, and patients are allowed to self-administer the intranasal spray. The device is made so that it's not that hard to give it to yourself, but you still need to be monitored for about 2 hours in the doctor's office. So this is not going to be something that you get a prescription for and you pick it up from the pharmacy and you give it to yourself at home, because there might be some few people who would have a very significant spike in blood pressure or heart rate, and that could lead to a stroke or a heart attack in some patients. So the office that administers this should be prepared to intervene in some way in that situation of a major shift in vital signs. The other reason why it's not going to be recommended to be given at home is that ketamine is a substance of abuse. It's been used on the street as Special K, usually in much higher doses than we recommend for depression, but ultimately it is something that we don't want to encourage or foster a certain pattern of addiction. And that's the second reason why it will be an in-office procedure. So my expectation is that it will be available for patients. It will be expensive, and probably only for a very tiny minority, it will be a long-term treatment. And for the majority of individuals that benefit from it, it will be essentially buying them time for other treatments, be them pharmacotherapies or device-based treatments or psychotherapies, to be effective, because those are starting to work much slower than ketamine does.